Hello, hello, everyone. Salutations. Gotta just do the audio mix and shenanigans. Make sure everything's balanced. Make sure we're in a good place with everything. I think we're pretty solid. Hello. How are you? I'm just trying a thing to see if we can get some of this, like, awkward background, some of that traffic noise, get that out of here, because I've got plenty of traffic. I've got a fan like right behind me, and we want to try and get that out, because there's no reason for that to be like audible. There's no reason for you to hear that and deal with that. We want to now rebalance everything. It's great. We're having a fun time. But we just want to make sure everything's nice. We can hear evenly, me and the music. The music's not too loud. I think this is a good place to be. I think we're in a good place now. I think we're in a good place. I agree. Do you agree? Do you concur? Tishmore? I don't know, man. It's hard with the delay. We're gonna say that's good. Okay. But salutations, friends. My name is Brianna Bond, otherwise known as No Ordinary Scholar. And let's go. Let's get into it. You've been waiting for it. I was dreading it, getting into this book. Book two of the Code of Silence series, Back Before Dark. Now, if you missed it the first time around for this series, the Code of Silence I read and reviewed, and I gave it 1 star. And it earned that 1 star. So, but the reason why I even read it in the first place was because when I was a lot younger, we all know lighting's never going to be a great situation here. It's fine. But when I was my sophomore year of high school, I read Back Before Dark during finals week. Because, you know, after you finish your final, you're not allowed to do like 99% of anything. So I read. And I finished. And this was a book that I read during that time. And I wanted to read it again. I purchased it a while ago, and when I purchased this, I was found out that there were 2 other books in the series, and I was like, oh, sure, let's check them out. Because I didn't have that same, like, visceral disgust I didn't, like, feel that when I read Back Before Dark. Otherwise, I obviously would not have purchased it, and I obviously would not have gone for the other books in the series. But I read the first one and I hated it. And let me clarify, the writing of it is good. The author is really good at writing. They were just trying to push a moral and a lesson to the story that literally made no sense, because they're like trying to push this whole lying's bad, you should never lie thing. But the lying is what kept these characters alive. And so it got to a point where it was so frustrating and so stupid and just so forced upon me that I just could not, like, I was literally at the point of, I'm so done with this book, I can't wait for it to be over. It should only be, like, a little bit more, right? Nope, you're only 30% of the way through the book. And that was me throughout the whole book, was like, oh my god, it should be over soon. Nope, nope, nope. But I didn't feel that at all with this book. So let's go over Back Before Dark, and let's talk about the good, the bad, and yeah. But overall, know that it's not as bad as the first book in the series was. Just, we can all have that sense of relief now. But, so, you have our characters. Cooper, who's really, for the most part, the main character. Cooper, Hero, Gordy, and Lunk. Lunk was the bully previously, but after some life or death experiences, they've become friends. They've started to become friends. So they're all riding their bikes around, And they see this van in the park that they're in, driving real slow. Their backpack is left on top. And they're all like, oh, should we be the good people and go warn them that there's a back, that their backpack is on top. We don't want them to, like, have it fall over. There could be something expensive in there. Like, we wouldn't want them to break that. So they end up daring Gordy, hey, if you can catch up, they're, like, really far away. If you can catch up before they leave, then I'll buy you some food. And as he's riding there, Hero gets, like, a really bad feeling, and she's like, we have to stop him, because at this point, the bag should have at least moved, and it's not moved an inch since they've been driving around, and it should have moved. What if it's, like, Velcroed to the top? What if this was a plan? What if someone's doing something? And so they try and chase him down. They try and stop him, but Gordy's like, nah, he can't really hear what they're saying, so he's just like, hey guys, what's up? He gets to the van, tells the person their backpack's on top, and it seems, we're not with Gordy, but it seems like they said, hey, can you just toss it inside for me? He goes, reaches to try and take it off, and it doesn't move. He gives it a bigger yank, still doesn't move. Then he gets tasered and thrown into the van, and then the van drives off. Cooper tries to chase them down, tries to get the license plate numbers, calls the cops, but at that point, Gordy's just gone. He loses sight of the car, Gordy's gone. So throughout the book, we have just Cooper feeling immensely guilty. He ends up accidentally getting the license plate number wrong, because realistically, he's stressed. He even goes to the school therapist, because his teacher kind of makes him go to the school therapist, and the therapist is like, you're in a, like, extremely high stress situation. It's normal for your brain to not work right in that situation. So it makes sense. It's normal, and it's not your fault that you got the license plate number wrong. But he ended up mixing up the numbers. He feels guilty that he should have gone with Gordy. He should have recognized that it was a trap sooner, stuff like that. He feels extremely guilty. He also even, like, gets to a point where he feels like he would rather the kidnapper take him as opposed to his cousin, Gordy, because Gordy's his cousin as well. Gordy's his cousin and his best friend. So he feels very guilty. And there's just constant reminders around him. This book takes place over the course of, like, 3 days. And so there are constant reminders around them of of the disappearance of Gordy. So there's no one in his home. Nobody is at home, because his mom is with Gordy's mom constantly. They are at home sitting by the phone praying for a ransom call that doesn't come. Gordy's dad and Cooper's dad are driving around town trying to find the van, because in the location that they were at, they were right by a highway, and so they're looking to see, like, maybe they dropped it off, like, right outside of town. Maybe they dropped it off in a hospital or in a mall, someplace with a lot of other cars, so it can be, like, easier to hide. So they're driving around looking for the vans, and at school, of course, everyone knows what happens. Everyone's being asked for information, and everyone's giving him a lot of pity. And this guilt, as well as just a general, just grief over the situation, has caused him to do a lot of really crazy, not ideal things. Like, he starts breaking into a couple houses. He broke into one house. He broke into one house, and it was the house of the guy from the first book. They were trying to see if maybe he was taking revenge for them getting him jailed, and maybe even it was supposed to be Cooper that was supposed to be kidnapped, but they got Gordy instead. And so they broke into his house to investigate that whole place. There was a point where they looked up the local sex offenders, and there was one particular guy that he had a really bad feeling about, so he planted evidence. He planted a shirt of Gordy's that looked exactly like the one he was wearing that day in the front yard, and they had a woman across the street. They managed to borrow her phone, and while she wasn't looking, they called the cops to give them a false tip so that way they could look through that house, because without substantial evidence and without reasonable cause, the police could not go in. And he was getting, there was a lot of times where he was very frustrated and very, like, he wasn't listening to people when they're saying, like, we have to do these things legally, we can't just go into their house. Which, at the fact of the matter is, if, like, even if you just have a bad feeling about something, without evidence they cannot go in. And if they did go in, and like with the sex offender, they did not find anything, but if they just gone in for no reason, then they probably would have had to stop the entire search for Gordy, so that way whatever state or whoever, if the person whose house they searched decide to press charges, you have to stop the investigation for Gordy, so that way the state or the federal level or whoever can investigate the cops that are not following the law, and that's going to make the situation even worse. But Cooper is just not okay. He's committing a lot of risks, he's doing a lot of bad things, he's not in a great place. We get to a point where he's past the guilt, but he feels the need to do something. He still feels the need to do something to help. He gets to school, I think this is like the third day, and he sees a poster on the door inviting students to a memorial service for Gordy. And I don't think anyone, like, in the family had been notified that they were doing this, which I do think it's quite inappropriate for a school to host a memorial service prior to, like, without the knowledge of the parents, especially because, like, I think it's inappropriate for a school to decide that they're going to deem someone dead before the police, before the parents. Because no one in this family, none of the cops were aware of this. Everyone was blindsided by these posters they had everywhere, like, for a memorial service for Gordy, especially Cooper. And he had a breakdown over it, and I think that really pushed him over the edge. Again, he's not doing this out of guilt, but he wants to do whatever he can to try and find Gordy. And so recently, the past couple nights, he has been going to the park in which Gordy was kidnapped at night to pray, because he felt like he needed to feel the danger and the fear that Gordy felt in that moment in order to really feel closer to God when he is praying for Gordy's safe return. And everyone around him's like, this guy's a creep, we think he stayed local. So, and he's just, like, under a rock and waiting to crawl back out. So Cooper's like, Cooper, I think, flat out asks his therapist, do you think this guy would kidnap again? Therapist says yes, but he doesn't really know why Cooper's asking. Cooper ends up trying to get himself kidnapped, and he does, because we also do get to see point of view of Gordy and point of view of the kidnapper, though they don't name the kidnapper, but they might as well have. And we know the kidnapper's been watching him. Kidnapper was going there at night as well to relive the glory. And he decides, oh, it'd be great if I could commit a double kidnapping. That'd be 10-10. So he does end up kidnapping Cooper as well. And takes him to the place that he had taken Gordy. Thing is, it's been raining like no other in this town, and the river was overflowing. And because they are currently keeping him in an abandoned house, the sump pump, which should keep water levels away from the house, wasn't on. So the basement was almost completely flooded. And the guy originally was going to be like, this was just supposed to be my way of showing the police that I'm smarter than them. This is just supposed to be a game. I don't want you guys to die, so I'm going to let you out, wait 5 minutes after I leave, and then you can go to the neighbor, ask them to, like, help you out. But Cooper sees something that can help him identify the guy. So because he can identify him, he decides to leave them to die. And at this point, the reason why we end up finding them is because Hero and Lunk have started breaking into garages to try and find these vans. Because, like, they're sick of losing people. So they start breaking into garages of all the abandoned houses in that area. And they're able to find the garage that has the van with the backpack, as well as the second van, and they go through, see a lock on the basement door, break it open, and it's full of water. They call the cops. Cooper's dad is a certified diver, so he is able to dive in, finds them, and we're able to save everybody. Like, the place is completely flooded, but what ends up happening is Cooper pulls some, like, crazy shit. Because, what's his face? Gordy has been out of food for a couple days. He has had no form of heating. He's almost hypothermic. So Cooper ends up taking, because he has a diving knife from that he took from the house, cuts open the roof, wraps insulation around Gordy to try and keep him warm, and then cuts some PVC pipe for them to use as snorkels when the water level reaches the above their heads. And that was just shoved into the flooring, so that way they had whatever little air they could get. But they were found safe and sound-ish, and everyone's alive, everyone was okay. It's a happy-ish story. They also found the guy and were able to arrest him. Let's talk about this guy. We only see him from the point of view of who this person is. See the person, see their name. There's like one scene that they're in which we actually see the name of the person. And this author was not great at slipping it in. This author was not great at, you know, like, weaving it well into the story. So the kids are handing out flyers and asking people to put flyers of Gordy on business windows. And they go to this gamer shop. And this is the only person that, I think there are like three people we get a name for, and he's the only one that actually gets any like sort of real backstory or real character development somewhat. And that right away is an immediate, oh, he's the bad guy. He's the only one outside of our main group that we know anything about. He's obviously the bad guy. But what's more is his name is Tyler King. He is a gamer. He wears this ring that is a skull with a crown on it. And for no reason, Hero's like, hey, I like your ring. And then he goes into the backstory of how he's a gamer and his gamer tag is like the like King of Death or something. Or Death King. And then we leave and they're like, did you actually like his ring? No, of course not. I agree. Of course not. This is absolutely outside of Hero's character for her to like that ring. And it was also counterintuitive to the things that they were trying to do. It distracted him from, like, he was already in the middle of agreeing to put the posters up, and she distracted him by talking about this ring. So what purpose was there for the ring, aside from the fact that Cooper seeing the ring later is what helped him identify who the kidnapper was? That was literally the only purpose to that conversation at all. It was not even natural for the characters to have that conversation. And the author acknowledges that it was not natural for them to have that conversation, and yet doesn't give us a reason for why that conversation existed, aside from the fact that it is going to identify this guy later. So that's a thing. Another thing, and one of the reasons why I like kind of got irritated with the book is there's some parts of it that the author's so redundant and literally saying the exact same thing over and over again. particularly with, it felt like every other page, the author was reminding us that it was raining so much, and it was raining more than ever, and that the river was gonna overflow and flood basements. They were reminding us of that so often, and they were also constantly reminding us that there are so many, like, foreclosures around that area, and they're also constantly reminding us that, they're one of the sex offenders in the area, his house was foreclosed, and I like that misleading there. Again, it would have been better if you didn't have such a heavy, obviously Tyler King is the kidnapper vibes that they put out by, you know, giving him so much story and having this random fucking ring conversation. I did like that, but they pressed it so much. Again, that guy's name was on like every other page, and it was too much. So it got to the point where it was so overwhelmingly obvious. And the reason why it was so annoying is because we did get the story from Gordy's point of view. We saw that, like he said, all the power and none of that stuff was on. The sump pump wasn't going, even though it was raining. And, like, we saw from his point of view that the basement was starting to flood. So, I would have preferred it if the author left more of that to our own, like, figurings, if that makes sense. If the author had left us to figure that out and put those pieces together with what's going on with Gordy versus one or two hints of, like, the constant rain and the foreclosures nearby, as opposed to literally beating the shit out of that dead horse. That was one. There was also a thing that hit me. There were a couple times where it felt like, yes, the book was Christian fiction, but I feel like they kind of overdid it to the point where it doesn't feel natural to the story anymore. Like at the very beginning, Cooper is like on the phone with the police as he's riding his bike to continue to follow this van so he can get their license plate number and try and like find where they're taking Gordy. And he gets back, he was on the phone with the police, and then after that he loses the van, goes back to try and find Hero and Lunk. He finds Hero praying, and he says, and he like kind of scolds himself with the line, he'd gotten a call off to 911 but hadn't thought to call on God. Stupid. And like, one, it makes it seem like they think he should have called 911 later and prayed instead, which is just no. That's a solid, I'm gonna have to say no to that one. But what's more upsetting is that it's out of character for the character of Cooper. Like, from the first book, he is not crazy, crazy religious. He's religious, but he isn't nearly as religious as Hero is. And so it doesn't feel right for him to, like, have that response to the situation. As well, even in this book, he doesn't pray a ton, but he does pray relative to someone who is pretty casually religious and just lost someone. And he even feels like he couldn't pray properly unless he was in like that area of heightened fear, like from the being in the kidnapping area. Like, he doesn't feel like and that makes sense for him, but for him to like have this sudden break of he should have prayed before calling on 911 felt super out of character with him, as well as like, I don't think that's great advice for kids. Secondly, there was this one moment where we're in Gordy's point of view for the first time as he is getting in the kidnapper's van and they're about to put him in the basement, and he describes the taser as a demon gun. And at first that was really, like, I thought that was a really great description. But again, they kept beating the dead horse and they constantly referred to it as the demon gun, demon taser. And it just, it pulls you out of the story when, because it doesn't feel as natural to refer to something with the same, like, description 40 times in a row. What else? There was, like, some, like, towards the end, as Cooper got, like, more and more desperate and, like, crazed about the situation, there were some, like, iffy discussions about suicide that I do not, like, really appreciate. But, yeah, it was thankfully very brief. And something else I'd actually really like is the way that the author actually did integrate the phrase back before dark into the story, because it's such a normal part of, like, a lot, because the idea was that their parents wanted them back before dark, especially after there was, like, the whole attempted murder stuff in the last book. And so it makes sense for them to use it in that way. And it didn't feel like a roll credits moment, which I have to give it to the author. I have to give them that, as well as just in general, this book and the last book, they're really good at making the audience feel the tension and the anxiety. I'm sure you can hear everything that's going on outside. Sorry. But they're really good at making the audience feel the tension and the anxiety that the character's feeling, making them feel just all of the emotions that are going on. The author's really good at that. And it's no different with this book. I was super emotional, I was super sad, I was, like, anxious, stressed, but in the end, everything turned out okay for everybody. It was great. Really appreciate it. So, in general, this book, the reason why I want to read the third book is more or less because I own it, and because I want to see if you have to read the first book in order to understand that book. Based on the description, yes. But it would really be ideal if you didn't, and that's what I'm here to tell you. Because again, this author's really good at telling the story and at making you feel these emotions that are going on with the characters. But it was the issue with the first book was they were trying to push a moral that juxtaposed the actual story and the actual plot, and they went triple down with that moral because it didn't make sense with the story they were telling. It was so frustrating and so exhausting to read. But you didn't get that with this book, so we'll see what happens in the next book. What we are going to be reading next in this line of shenanigans is Cemetery Boys by Aiden Thomas. There's so much stuff going on outside. We're reading Cemetery Boys by Aiden Thomas. I've already started it. I am super excited to continue reading this book. Fingers are crossed. My goal is to have this book ready to stream and talk about next week. That is my goal. We will see what happens. Thank you so much for being here. And until next time, valedictions, friends.